Guys, thank you so much for being here. Thank you. It's crazy. We heard there was a line outside for this. Really appreciate it. So.
3, 2, 1.
Welcome to Future Funk. How it's made. With Fiber.
And Discoholic.
Thank you guys again. Thank you guys so much for coming out. All right. Let's get started here. Right? Let's begin. Where it all began? Huh? Well, we tested that 15 times. And
it's of all times for.
Out of all times.
Try it again.
All right, let's go back.
Go back and go forward.
Let's pretend that didn't happen.
Okay.
There you go.
Okay.
Cool. All right. Hi, everybody. I'm Fiber. I've been a musician and producer for over 10 years now. You know, when I was young, I heard Daft Punk's One More Time. I said the story last year, but I tried to spend a while figuring out who made it. Pretty much like over half my life at that point because I was a very young kid. But once I did, it was life-changing. I barreled towards the world of electronic music. I've never looked back. And pretty much all of my experiences so far have been just formative and life-changing. Got really into physical releases, and I'm going to bring down the volume just a little bit. It's a little too loud.
Otherwise, we turn it up because this song rocks.
No, well, I don't need to try.
Okay, cool. So, get that out of there. All right, cool. So, I got into physical releases. I started collecting a lot of vinyl when I was around 13. And got into French House and started studying the disco greats. The first record label that I signed to was Aeroflor. Shout out Rob Clems. They're in the audience with us today from the United Kingdom. They were my first ever online music friend. I would not be here without them. So everybody just give them a round of applause, please. All right, so eventually I joined the Future Funk scene. It felt like a home to me. You know, we're just young kids, unfiltered access to the internet, ripping YouTube tracks and, you know, just like taking the MP3s and flipping them. We're making really formative memories. You know, at one point I joined Future Society, and then I released, you know, with Neon City, Core Spec, Mrs. Casual, My Pet Flamingo, and more. Recently we've been working on Montem, which is my record label. I co-run with Discoholic, with releases from The Phantom's Revenge, Agrume, Andrew 52, and the ball-headed idiot himself. So, I also finally graduated from college. I'm so glad to be done. My favorite pastimes, they somehow include touching grass, but also not touching grass, if you can believe that. I love hiking. I love gaming, specifically rhythm games. And I love to code. You can see what I mean by intermittently touching grass, right? Does that make me a Silicon Valley type disco?
Yeah,
like, I'm a software dev.
You like hiking.
What's up?
You like hiking.
Yeah.
Do you have like a custom keyboard?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
It costs like $400.
Yeah, Patagonia.
Like at least 3 jackets. Oh shit. Wait, and I'm wearing Allbirds right now. Oh God, what? Holy shit, what am I? Okay. But either way, let's forget about that for a second. I've also grown a pretty big passion for playing the guitar lately. I'm trying to focus on bringing music into my own personal life that isn't just attached to my digital audio workspace, which is Ableton. If you haven't heard my music, you're listening to it right now. I have some albums out. The only official album is Fiber 2014-2016. Initially released on Savona and then re-released on Neon City Records. I also put out 810, my first ever EP, and then Rendezvous, which is my latest EP from 2019, and then a secret third thing that I'm working on.
What do you mean a secret third thing?
Yeah, like a third thing, like the third thing. I haven't listed a third thing.
There's already three up there.
Wait, what?
We can fix it when we do.
Wait,
the panel.
One,
we,
two.
We can fix it. Okay,
we'll fix it before the presentation. No worries. All right, let's move on. So, few singles, Virtual World, most popular single of mine. It is a love song to my fiance, Sarah. I am so proud of it to be one of my best and most popular songs. I couldn't ask for a better song for that to happen to. I did The Only One, Don't Stop Me. It's a re-released Future Society single. Recently did Here's to You, which is my sequel collab with EB.exe. And I got to work on Session, Star Guardian, Talia this year, which was I got to work with Riot Games, which is really, really cool. Did entirely original tunes, explored some genres I otherwise wouldn't have been able to. So, you know, it's just really, really cool. We've been doing a lot of stuff this year.
Yes, so. And speaking of original tunes, we'll be getting into that later. But that's Fiber, everyone. But
Fiber.
Anyways, enough about him. What are you doing with your mic, boy?
What was up?
Switch the slide over.
I already did.
Oh shit! Hi.
Oh, okay. So as you guys see, actually, it's not there. He'll tell you.
Okay. Hi, I'm a discoholic, and you might be too. It all started when my dad played Change, A Lover's Holiday, in the car many moons ago. And here I am now. I've been a pianist for over a decade. I've been a PP, a pianist producer.
And You've been a what?
I've been a pianist producer. I've been a...
What have you been?
I've been a PP... A pianist producer.
What was that again?
I've been a PP.
Anyways.
Can you let me finish? I've been a PP.
What is yours?
A pianist producer for over half a decade and a half. And I've been producing new disco music for 2/3 of that time. And I've been DJing for 1/5 of that time. And, Fiber. So the reason I'm here is because Fiber found me on SoundCloud a couple of years ago. And he asked me to join his new disco future funk house label, Montem. It turned out we lived an hour from each other in the same state, Maryland. Which we are in here, right now.
Unfortunately.
Yeah. Do you like Old Bay?
I do, but I don't like crabs.
Okay.
I do not like crabs.
I know,
Hang Me by the Gallows, I know.
He showed me the fascinating world of future funk, and while I'm no FF future funker, I'm definitely a future funk enjoyer, FFE. I am blind.
He can't see anything. That's why he didn't even know that I was on the next slide.
Yeah.
Let's move on.
You need proof. So if you don't know the Discoholic universe, the DCU, the Discoholic Cinematic Universe, and if you like the funk behind Future Funk, two albums for you to check out. In 2017, the first Discoholic album dropped, and it was the dreamy debut album Illusion, which told the story of the cyclical nature of love. Half a decade after that, fast forward to 2022, Discoholics Anonymous dropped a bold and fun revival of the spirit of disco infused with vibrant flavors of R&B, kind of raising the bar and serving up more fun, meaningful, and impressive music. That was the whole idea. So, two albums to check out if you enjoy the funk behind Future Funk. And if you're telling me albums aren't my thing, well, maybe singles are your thing. So check out these four singles: Disco Soul, Lift Off, Disco Dance, 7 a.m. Going on Midnight, all released on Montem. Funny about that.
I own your IP. That's awesome.
Okay. So,
all right, what have we been up to?
Yeah, since our last panel, what 2022 recap? Let's go.
All right, let's do this.
Yeah. Woo! Woo! Okay, yeah. Hell yeah. I like
so,
that.
So, this, like this album dropped. So this was in LA for Groove Continental, the pop-up.
Yeah.
So, really fun.
That was in New York.
Yep. So this was Disco going ham on the cowbell during the pop. Yeah, and he gave me COVID. Thanks
That's
for that.
Cool.
I dressed up as Lord Farquaad for Shrek Rave. I mean, look at the hair. It's perfect. What the hell?
That's my string.
This is me playing Starships at Bikini Bottom Rave.
This man played a lot of shows.
I played 10 shows.
That was in Philly.
This is Terminal H Hill. Yeah, running in the 90s. What the? You're not even white, bro.
Not yet. Arlington, Virginia.
Yeah, this is in Richmond for Circuit Zero, and this is a Shrek rave.
I had a little green bow tie and Shrek ears. Yeah.
I can't believe they let us do this. This is at Yoitoki a few weeks ago. Shout out Alex X Stefani for filming this, actually, if he's in the crowd. We dressed up as Majo Chillin' for Halloween.
Yeah.
So like he's the disco ball head, and I'm like the bowling ball dude.
Yeah.
This is also at Yoitoki.
So many shows, this boy.
Who put me up on stage? Like, I actually somewhat know, like, I know what I'm doing. I look like it, at least. The signs are a staple. Oh, he real wide. What Hello. The? Did you Hello. Put this in? Yo, now she's kind of bad, baby. Though. What's her number? And this is Virtual World live edit. I started singing in my sets.
Yeah, so.
So.
That doesn't cover everything, but it's a little summary.
Crazy year, 2022. So.
This is Future Funk, how it's made. And to understand
God, how all of our made, songs are not playing when we go to the slides.
Okay, well, there you go. Yeah, you just had to like nudge it.
Yeah, I have to like display the slide twice for some stupid reason, but it's okay.
To understand what Future Funk is, we need to understand that it's really a subgenre of Vaporwave. You can see it in a lot of Future Funk's aesthetics, a fascination with the retro, especially the 80s to 90s, with Vice City Dreams of Walkman players, cars with built-in cassette decks, and FM stereos. Unlike its Vaporwave dad, though, Future Funk has a dash of anime in its aesthetics too, and its sound is more upbeat, funky, and oftentimes housey. And the key to the sound is often made up of recontextualizing old funk into the future, hence Future Funk. City pop, which was Japan's brief flirtation ship with Western soft rock, R&B, funk, and boogie in the 80s, is a huge inspiration for Future Funk, thanks to the YouTube algorithm. You've probably heard this city pop classic, Mariah Takeuchi's Plastic Love. You've heard it before.
If you haven't, you're listening to it right now. Yeah. So.
Okay. But yeah, Future Funk musicians, they chop up these city pop samples, and if not city pop, something similarly retro and funky. And they often add housey four on the floor drums, inch, 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 and sometimes the occasional funk bass line on top. Who makes it?
So. There you go. Got the music to play. So there's quite a few artists in the future funk scene. You're looking at two of them. But there are bigger artists as well. You know, we got Young Bay, Vantage, Night Tempo, Saint Pepsi, Tanuki, Macross, Desired, a bunch of other labels. But a lot of these artists, for some of them, like future funk isn't even like their main thing. I mean, Tanuki's done so much stuff with Namco Bandai, like VGM stuff. I think he has a track on like Dance Rush Stardom.
Yeah, Dance
Andrew 52,
Rush.
Moe Shop also I think have a track up on there. I think the closest one to like, I guess like pure like city pop stuff would be Night Tempo, because he's doing these like licensed remixes for like Henri, Miki Matsubara, Wing,
yeah.
1968 Omega Tribe, Junko Yagami. You know, Vantage, I mean, he's collaborating with Todd the God Edwards.
Todd Edwards, yes.
I mean, that's just crazy. He's remixed for Dua Lipa. I mean, so he's also like in that sphere as well. Macross 8299 also is just doing like a lot of juke trap, bubblegum bass, future bass. I think his upcoming album is probably gonna have a lot more of that, like less future funk stuff. So there is a lot of variation in the scene. So we talk a bit about who makes it, you know, and also like the record labels as well. We kind of cited these record labels, but the coolest and most important one of all is Montem, obviously. Nobody else here matters. No, just kidding. These are all good friends of ours. But yeah.
Now, the great
Where is Future Funk?
Where is Future Funk? The great thing about internet-based genre is that you can easily find Future Funk online. See? with an internet-based genre, you can find it on streaming platforms, not just SoundCloud, YouTube, Bandcamp, and such, but it's, you know, spread to, like, official streaming services like Apple Music, Spotify, Deezer, Amazon,
LimeWire,
and a secret Napster. Fifth thing. And Spotify even recognizes it as an official genre in their Future Funk playlist. And what is a retro, what is retro music if not being able to be heard on retro hardware? I worded that so clunkily. Vinyl, tape, CDs, mini discs, floppy discs, even Game Boy Advance cards. Online communities as well, with Discord servers like r/FutureFunk, subreddits like also r/FutureFunk. It's also a Discord.
Yeah, you said Vapor Vinyl already, right?
It's pretty cool.
Yeah, there's the there's also a bunch of Facebook groups. There's the Future Funk Vinyl Collectors Facebook group. If you'd like to get zucked off, like, it's on Facebook.
That's so cool. Live events. Future Funk is even near you. Electronicon 3 in New York City. Young Bay's Groove Continental pop up in LA. And Young Bay's Groove Continental all over the US. Young Bay, you know, supporting for Madion's Good Faith Forever tour. And Neon City Cruising, which is going around the world and Japan. And
yeah, the US. They just did a Tokyo show, and then I think they had like an Osaka date, and I think it got canceled due to health reasons or something like that. Yeah, but that was in the pipeline. We already mentioned Good Faith Forever, right?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes,
and then if you scan that just goes to the Future Funk playlist on Spotify. It doesn't like link.
Yeah, sorry about the misleading graphic.
Yeah, it's like continuity, you know.
Anyways, so Future Funk is big. So why is Future Funk big? Why is Future Funk so good? Well, I think it boils down to three main factors. Nostalgia, right? You ever heard of this term called anamoya? Oh. Nostalgia for a time you've never known. And I think Future Funk really taps into that, right? I suspect that none of us really were alive during the disco era. And it's really true. I think society has just an infatuation with the retro.
We can't say that nobody has.
Okay. Well, I'm just saying, most of us. Hi.
Hello.
We love you. But like Stranger Things, right? Think of this, like Stranger Things. That's like one of the biggest like things in pop culture. And like, that was all in the 80s, right? Dua Lipa and like The Weeknd, they're doing like 80s synthwave stuff.
Yeah, doesn't Dua Lipa have like that levitating music video that is like very like 90s like Sailor Moon animation inspired sort of stuff? Yeah.
Yeah, so the point is, people, it just taps into the retro that society, that pop culture is so infatuated with. And it's just danceable, right? A lot of Future Funk is just, right? You can easily follow that, you know? Dum-dum-dum-dum. It's very danceable, 4-on-the-4 house drums. You can get your mom to Future Funk. You can get your friends to Future Funk on the dance floor. And accessibility, with a tight-knit community of producers, artists, and fans on the internet. And, you know, with an internet-based genre, everything's just a click away. So, how do you make it?
All right, this leads us to the big question. So we talked a bit about this last year. You know, we're not here for a history lesson like we did. But the interesting part is that, you know, when we think about Future Funk and a lot of electronic-based genres, we think about sampling. The cool thing about sampling is that you don't necessarily just have to be, like, sampling, like, a disco track or something like that. How many people here know what sampling is? All right. And, like, just... Let's just get somebody to tell us, you know, what do you think sampling is? Anybody? Yeah.
Let me have previously recorded a piece of music and repurposing
it through. Got it. Okay. That's pretty good. Yeah. Anybody else? How would you define it?
Wait, that projector was blinding me. Who else? What?
Apparently,
I can't
also
hear you, I'm blind. Deaf.
All right. So, wait one sec. What were you saying?
So, all the same doesn't necessarily have to be.
That's That's exactly. That's the part I wanted to run home about.
Wow,
yeah.
Damn.
So the thing about sampling, right, is that you don't necessarily have to be sampling a disco track or any track itself that exists, you know, like out, like, you know, something that somebody already created, right? You could, like, you know, take a sample, could be any recorded piece of audio that you are manipulating to your own advantage. You could record your guitar. You could scream into a microphone and then chop that up. You can, you know, go on Splice and get royalty-free packs and, like, use those. You could even, you know, take a snare drum and manipulate that, and that would still count as sampling. So that's something to kind of run home about, because I think a lot of future funk artists, they could probably, like, put themselves, like, in this box of thinking that, like, you know, I have to sample a disco track or something that, like, conventionally will turn into a future funk track for it to be future funk. And there's no rule that says that, you know? And once you realize that, like, I think, you know, you can garner up, like, you can come up with, like, a lot more creative sort of things. And the interesting part is that, you know, regardless if you're a beginner or, like, an advanced producer, you know, sampling is just a great way to, like, you know, get your production chops, you know, worked up, you know, trying to kind of, like, refine, like, that skill. The way that you work, it just, in music production in general, it really does matter, you know? If you're consistent, even if you're not doing anything like in your DAW or something like that, if you do something that's like 10 to 30 minutes like a day, just dedicated towards music, like, for example, when I'm feeling uninspired, instead of like making music, I'll like, you know, process drums or make sounds like in like a synth and then bounce those to audio and like store them aside so that I can use them for later. Because when I'm in the music making process, I just want to sound quickly. And if I can't really, you know, if I can't really find anything, then I'll just go for like a preset or something like that. So there's kind of ways to do it and to kind of like improve that workflow. And, you know, the interesting part about sampling is that the more that you do it, especially if you're sampling like disco tracks, you start to pick up on practices, motifs, structure, like in those disco tracks that will influence your music, you know, yes. Even if you're making original stuff.
Yes, a lot of music creation involves a lot of music listening.
Exactly. Getting better at making music is a listening exercise in itself. So exposing yourself to good music that inspires you is a really good way of doing that. So so speaking of sampling...
You guys seem to be smart cookies. So we got a little quiz, a little interactive section for you guys.
We kind of did something like this last year. It's just going to be a bit shortened.
Yeah.
So... Let's jump into it. It's a sample quiz. Of course the music stopped playing.
It was literally playing.
All right, we're good now. So, let's see if you know the sample to this classic, Saint Pepsi's Cherry Pepsi, from Hit Vibes' legendary track, right? Is it A, The Limit Miracles, B, Sister Sledge, Bring Your Own Baby, BYOB, C, Chic Super One, or D, Psy Gangnam Style? What? Okay, show hands
Wait,
for
did you
A.
Say B or D?
Show hands for A. Okay, what about B? Okay, what about C? Okay, D? Okay. All right, sweet.
Here's
okay,
the
and the answer
drum roll,
is...
Drum roll, please.
Size Gangnam Style!
Hey!
Sexy lady! Wait.
Just kidding, guys.
What? Did you put that in?
Huh?
Did you put that in?
So I put that in. Si made the song.
You said "oh" and then edited the slides?
No, Si made the song. Si made Gangnam Style.
Okay, stupid. Okay, enough of this. Enough of this. Okay, it's obviously it's
B.
Signed off. Who the fuck signed off on that?
Okay. I don't know. Si did.
Moving on. Okay, so that one is kind of like a gimme.
That's easy mode.
What about a deeper cut?
Yeah.
This is like a future funk producer's album. Like an album that it has inspired a lot of future funk artists. Backed by Popular Demand by Prune. There's a track on it called Missing Love. And we want to see whether or not you guys know the sample. Is it A, Atlantic Stars Love Me All Over Again? B, Kashif's Help Yourself to My Love? C, Anita Baker's Same Old Love 365 Days a Week? Or D, Phyllis Hyman, What You Won't Do for Love? All right. Show hands for A. Show of hands for B. Okay, C. All right, and D. Okay, it's very split. Let's see what the answer is. It's A. Yeah, it's a harder one. It's a harder one, for sure.
I think we made it too hard.
Well, I guess we'll fix it before the presentation.
We'll fix it when we do the panel.
We'll fix it when we do the panel.
Yeah.
All right. So now we've done the sample quiz.
Yes.
Let's remake these songs in Ableton right now, right?
Yes.
And then after we remake those two tracks, we are going to create an 100% original Future Funk track live for you guys today. Okay? So what's going to happen is for the original portion, Disco is going to work on a sample. He's going to bounce that file over to me, and I'm going to start flipping it on my end, and we're going to try to make something right here right now. Okay?
Yeah, so.
So let's work on the remix first, and then we'll go from there.
Same Pepsi, Cherry Pepsi. Go.
All right, let's just let's do some quick finagling of the. Oh, let's.
Go.
Is this better? Oh, okay. I see what you mean. Yeah. All right. Just bringing our mixer down a little bit so we don't blow it. All right. All right.
Yeah.
You guys see this? Hello.
Hello. All right. Ableton
so
Live.
We have Sister Sledge's BYOB loaded up in Ableton right now. Original. Sorry, I had to bring up the volume. So the original BPM for this was 132 BPM and a half. It's not exact, you know, just an older track. Probably sampled off of vinyl as well, so there's like a speed variation. So let's go ahead and take a look at this sample. And I'm actually going to try to see. Okay, we'll move the sidechain real quick. Let's get this started. Hey, 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 hey. All right, so we're going to take a look at this. We're going to keep playing it. We're going to bring it down to 109 BPM, okay? We're going to slow it. All right, definitely a bit slower, cool. We're going to bring it down one semitone, so one half step down.
There it is.
There it is.
All right. Panel's done. We did it. Thank you, guys.
All right. Thank you guys for coming.
What are you doing? No. We're just kidding. This is another one of our jokes.
Laugh. Come on. More. More laughter.
Okay. Just stick.
God, I'm hilarious.
No,
okay. Cool.
Do the sample.
So, yeah, so that's not all. There's definitely a few more nuances in this track. So the first part right here, this first sample that I'm gonna highlight, is actually layered over the second sample right here. So these two measures. So it's actually layered like this, right? And then there's a guitar chop at this portion right here. So we're just gonna do this guitar chop real quick. And then let's listen to how it sounds. It's just like a very, very minute difference. Makes the track feel a little bit fuller. And you'll hear this chop right here. It's just like a da-da, you know? So what we're gonna do is we're going to duplicate this loop, right? And that's not all. We actually have a few vocal samples in here. Because if you remember in BYOB, I'm sorry, in in Cherry Pepsi, there's like a like sample. So we're gonna look at that as well. Gonna bring us this down to key, and we're gonna play this. So that's the first sample right there. Gonna put that to the side, and then there's another sample. And then there's this. So, gonna grab it and put this over our loop, right? And there's actually some EQ going on here. So there's some like high passing and whatnot. So just keep that in mind. So that's the first one right there. And then the second one. Gonna do some light mixing real quick. Something like that, right? So I'm gonna add some sidechain on this. Just working with LFO tools, just basic volume automation, right? Just giving it that more puppy feel to give room for the kick snares.
Makes room for the drums.
Right. So for the kick, we're looking at just like a regular Vengeance kick layered with a Lin drum. So we're gonna bring it in real quick. I think what we're actually gonna do is we're gonna start it right here. And just duplicate it. Okay, so we got the kick, right? All right. We're gonna bring in a hi-hat and a snare. The snare is just a pitched down 707 snare with a bunch of compression on it and some reverb. That's all we're working with here. It's very, very simple. So we're gonna just go ahead and drop that in there. Actually, it's a little offset. And let's listen to this. Let's see what we got here, actually. So there you go. Let's take a listen to what we got. Sounds pretty similar to the original. I don't know about you guys. It is, but there's actually a small part in this. So a lot of people think that this is just like a flip, right? There is actually original instrumentation in this track. We were talking to St. Pepsi Ryan. He gave us his blessing to take a look and deconstruct this track. He actually let us know that there is a guitar line that is played on top. It's like a one note, like kind of like plucky sort of thing that is going on in the beginning. And then at the filter breakdown at around like, I would say probably like 40 seconds or so, there is this like a line that is being played. And that line, this is, as far as I know, not public information. It was played on a first act limited edition Volkswagen guitar with like a built-in overdrive that you put batteries into. And this guitar was like given as like a free gift when you bought a Volkswagen car.
What? So
Volkswagen... and the serial number of the car that you buy was printed on the headstock of the guitar itself.
So wait.
So the guitar that he was playing on this and also his like previous projects as well was probably done on like just this free guitar. You don't need expensive gear to make good music.
So Volkswagen, they made a guitar?
No, they partnered with First Act.
Oh, okay.
Right? Which is just like this intro guitar company. Like, I don't know if you guys had like a First Act guitar, like growing up, just like cheap thing, you know? And yeah, Volkswagen just gave out free guitars for like this car that they sold for a while as like a promotional thing.
That's based.
So let's listen to the full breakdown real quick. Yeah, and for like that guitar picking, we're gonna take a look at this. Like, so we actually recorded this prior. Right? It's just like a guitar picking thing, right? And then the line itself sounds like this. So it's just like an amp, right? It's just a completely clean signal with an amp, a bit of compression, high pass, and then just like a bit of delay on it. That's it. A lot of rhythm guitar is just like a very like clean signal for the most part. You just, you know, it's more about the rhythmic effects of it. So let's listen to the full breakdown of the track. Bring that up a little bit. Of course, you gotta put OTT on the master. Yeah. And that guitar line that we were talking about is going to kick in like in a few measures. And this is the the sampling that we were talking about. So this is a different sample, and you have that guitar line on top of it.
It's so chill.
We're gonna jump into Missing Love in a bit. So yeah, that's St. Pepsi's Cherry Pepsi, basically. All right, we're gonna look at Missing Love real quick, and then afterwards we're gonna work on the original track.
We're just getting started. This is level one.
That was level one. Cruise track is level two, and then the original track is gonna be level three. So let's do this.
Yeah.
All right. Of course, I don't want to save that.
All right. So remember.
Goodbye. No, it's okay. We already saved it.
Prue's Missing Love uses an Atlantic Star sample.
Yep, it's Atlantic Star's "Loving You All Over Again." A lot of the stuff that is sampled in Future Funk as well is like way more upbeat, like 110 BPM or higher. This one's like a slow track, and it's like sped up to only like 100 BPM. So kind of like a mid-tempo sort of track. So let's take a listen to it and see what we have. I love Atlantic Star.
I love this song. I was gonna say I love this song.
No, I love Atlantic
Star. I love this song.
That's the first sample, by the way. Second sample coming up.
Damn.
Great track. Third one coming up. Fourth, fifth, and sixth. Small sixth sample. I'm gonna jump over to the seventh sample just for time. So you can see that the sampling of this track is pretty complex. We're already taking like eight different pieces out of this track. All right, we got a 9th and a 10th sample, and that's it. And this is the 10th one right here.
10th sample.
Yeah, kind of abrupt, but all right. Let's work on this. So first things first, this first sample that we were looking at, gonna loop it. All right. We're gonna speed it up to 100 BPM. We're gonna pitch it up one semitone. That's the intro. That's just the intro right there. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna loop this a few times, and we're gonna make the intro portion, and then afterwards, like the, how would I put it? Like the first part of the track, and then the quote unquote chorus. So, let's repeat it four times. Then we're gonna take the first half of that first sample, right? We're just gonna take three quarters of half of that. Actually, we're going to turn that off as well. Right? And then we're going to repeat it. And we're going to take the end of the sample, this portion right here. Right? We're going to put that there. I'm going to duplicate that measure once more. And then we're going to take the second sample right here. Just gonna remove this part entirely and drag the second sample in. I make it look easy, but of course there was a lot of brain power that was involved in
like
this.
This,
you know,
this is like such a different way of thinking.
Yep. So oops,
pitch it up.
So now it's kind of like resolving like a bit better, you know? It's not just like one sample that keeps repeating over and over again. And I'm gonna pitch all these samples up because I don't want that oopsie to happen again. So All right. We're going to duplicate that portion again. We're going to remove the second sample. We're going to go to our never sample, which is the sixth sample. I'm going to copy and paste it in. It's like doing brain surgery on this song. It's like wild, right?
How do you even like pick up that sample?
Yeah, I know.
It just goes that.
I don't think it's that one. Let's see. There is a seventh. I think it's the seventh sample. No, it's not. Nope. There you go. Actually, did we already mess with it? Where was that? Oh, there it is. I skipped over it. Silly me. So we're going to take the fourth sample and basically just repeat the first half of it. So it's, I guess technically we would say like a quarter measure of it. And this is what we get basically. So we're going to loop this. We have the intro, right? We're going to take an EQ to this. We're going to high pass it.
So you remove the lows.
Removing the lows so that we can make space for a bass line. Let's see what we got here. Oh, I'm gonna extend that out a little bit more, actually. There you go. So, I wanna add a sidechain on this. Okay, a bit more pumping. And I'm gonna add drums. So, I got to use sample drums and 808s. That I'm gonna layer on top. Okay, Ableton, please give me my grids back. There you go. Okay, here's kick. Alright, definitely bouncing now. Okay, we have a bass track in here that we wanna add, right? And this is where it really starts to shine. There you go. That's Prue's missing love, basically. Yeah. Yeah. A lot of these other samples, they contribute to other portions of this track. But the really cool part, and I really implore you guys to listen to Prue's Back by Popular Demand, is the fact that he really combines sampling from other tracks and original instrumentation in such a way that you can't tell which is which.
Yeah,
he wanted to create an album that blurred the lines between those two. And I think it did a really great job. Prue's actually provided us the original multi-tracks of this song so that we can actually take a look at the studio version of this, which is really, really cool. So we're just going to listen to the first part of it, and then we're going to work on the original track.
Uh-huh.
All right. The cool part about this track as well is that it has original vocals from Daniel on Test.
Yes.
And there's also really nice portions, like there's a nice e-piano, an electric keyboard, there's a mini Moog lead, so synths, there's a bass that we just talked about. There's also synth strings.
Oh, shit.
Right, it really adds to the track.
That's some weight.
You hear the vocals kicking in as well.
Okay.
Right, like, we'll take also a look at just, like, these individual stems, right? These are the original vocals. Right, you got these strings.
Wait, can you just play the intro? Just, like, his...
Yeah, yeah. Well, what's up? Wait, which part? Right here?
Yeah, he's just saying facts.
What facts? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. This part right here. Like it or not, this dude's speaking straight facts.
Yeah.
All right. So, yeah, it's a great track. You know, again, there's electric keyboard as well, you know. Just lush, you know. That's not part of the sample, you know. He wrote that. So. Cool bass. Nice synth bass as well.
Cool bass.
All right. Is it time, Disco?
Is it? It is time.
I think it's time.
So this was Level 2, Prue's Missing Love. Now, these previous two tracks, they used existing samples that were made like 30 years ago. What if we made a sample 0 years ago? What if we made it
right now, actually?
And we turn it into future funk. This is where I come in. So we're going to switch it over to my screen.
All
right. Right? And then I'm working in FL Studio, but it doesn't matter what digital audio workstation I use. I started on Mario Paint, so I've come a long time.
Honestly, I started on Audacity.
Yeah. What was that like Music Maker for the PS2? Was it literally just called Music Maker?
I know what you're talking about. Yeah. It was a DAW in the PS2, but I don't know, man.
Anyways.
Make your music, white boy.
Yeah, okay. So can you see my screen? I can't. Okay, so we're just gonna make a simple disco beat, right? So let's just do. So let's just. It's just a drum machine sample. So this is a kick from the Lin machine.
Mr. Lin himself. Well, I guess he's actually a real person, Roger Lin. I thought I was just Roger being funny, Lin. But
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, so Roger.
Just a kick and then clap. Hi-hats. Yes.
So that Lin kicks from the LM1.
And then the snare. Just a simple beat, right? To get the juices flowing, to get the blood pumping, to get people dancing. And add some cowbell.
Oh man, did we forget the cowbell?
Let's add some claps on it. Just to layer.
Can I make a makeshift cowbell out of like a white monster can somehow?
Okay. Yeah, that's something there. Okay. Let's add some shaker.
It's actually kind of working.
Okay, so I'm feeling that. So let's come up with the chord progression. So that's why I've got this trusty keyboard over here. So, let's come up with something. So, let's record over this groove. Maybe something like. Uh-huh. Something like that. Okay, so if we clean that up, sounds something like this. Right. But what is disco without a bass line? So to walk you through the plugins I've been using so far, that piano is a Keyscape for Omnisphere, and it is like $3 billion, but coming from someone who's been a PP for a decade and a half.
Man, I wish I had the volume boom again.
The money, it's so good. Right now I've got an upright piano loaded up on Keyscape, and so for the bass, let's do a slap bass, you know, get things rocking, get things funking in here. So I use a Scarby J bass, which is a slap bass for this sampler called Contact. So okay. So if we put that over this.
Wait, can you play the Seinfeld theme? Can you play it? Can you play the bass from
Okay.
Woo!
Anyways. I'm not done yet. Anyways, let's add that bass on, right? Okay.
That's really grooving. I really like that.
You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? I know what I'm saying. Let's add some, I think this is pretty much done. Let's add some strings, because what is disco without orchestral strings, right? To kind of add that lush, kind of add that sophistication over disco. So, so I also use Kontakt for the strings, this library called Session Strings Pro. So something light, kind of to just kind of glue it all together. I don't want anything, when I'm making the sample for someone else to flip, I don't want to make it too distracting. I want to give him a blank enough canvas, but still make it somewhat interesting for him.
To kind of give room as well, because if I'm going to flip it, I'm not just going to flip it and put drums over it. I'm probably going to want to add additional instrumentation to complement the nice parts.
Yes. Yeah. So, you know, just kind of do what the chords are already doing.
Ooh, very lush.
Just to kind of glue the whole arrangement together.
Need some volume automation going on as well.
And just for fun, let's make it a little fun. Let's add some bounciness with this little synth, right? So I don't know if you guys have heard Madonna's Holiday, but that has like a little kind of bouncy synth part that goes like, wait, turn it an octave up.
Kind of sounds like the Fortnite, like.
Holiday!
I just realized that, like.
What?
Can you do the Fortnite dance?
Huh?
Go on.
Anyways, yeah. So why don't we, let's add something inspired by it, so. Yeah, so. Something like it. You know, Madonna's not gonna sue us, so it's okay. And that all together sounds like this. And I think that's our sample.
Yeah.
We're not here to make a whole
song.
But this is good enough for him to flip. Let's pass it over to Fiverr.
All right, let's do this. Let's take this sample. Let's take a future funk track out of it. All right, can yours see my screen? Oh, rats.
Are you recording?
All right, let's see. Yeah.
Okay, sick.
Whoa. Okay, cool. Okay, quick time, honey. Where are you? Okay, there you go. Are we recording? Yes. Okay. So I was taking a look at the sample, right? I'm thinking we pitch it up like by two semitones. Oh. And I also want to like bring it up to, I think, maybe say 125 BPM. Already definitely a bit bouncier, right?
It's getting positive reactions.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking, right?
Okay.
So when I was messing with this a little bit, I was like trying to highlight some sections that I really liked.
Yeah.
So there's this section right here. This portion right here. Something like that. And I also want to take this little slap bass thing. Okay. So I'm thinking like something like this. So I was like just busy chopping this up. I don't know. It works, right?
It works.
So,
yeah.
You know, we got a track over here with like a filter, this auto filter right here. It kind of like modulates the envelope and brings a little bit of like resonance up in like the single as well. Oh, yes?
What kinds of things do you look for when you're choosing what to chop up?
Honestly,
that's a good question. Sometimes it like doesn't come down to even like picking like the best part. It's just kind of like what I feel like I can manipulate best. But yeah. So, you know, this, you know, you have this like snare like coming through. It's got that ch-ch-ch-ch-ch, right? Instead of like kick, snare, kick, snare. But I still want to use this for the intro. So I'm gonna run this through this chain with like a bit of compression. I got the RX 950 on it, which is it's like a software emulation of the the Roland S950. It's a sampler that Daft Punk used on their album Homework. Yeah.
Is it free?
No, but it's like $20. I think.
Oh well, that's pretty.
So
good.
It's pretty good. Vantage clued me in on it. So shout out to him.
Oh.
Shout out to us. Yeah. But
oh right, Vantage makes VSTs, doesn't he?
Yeah.
Damn.
I'm gonna bring it down in this filter, like in this like filter channel, and I'm just gonna remove any side chain that I might have here. So this is just kind of like compress it a bit. It's also bringing the volume down a bit, high passing it. I'm gonna add the filter on it on top, right?
Whoa, whoa.
Wow, wow.
Okay, stop.
Sorry, I went a little too hard there for a second. All right, so that's what I'm thinking for like the main like intro section. You know, whoa, that's very loud. Sorry about that.
If you're not
yeah,
red
and that's
lighting,
like, and that's
light.
Actually where like most of the chops are coming from, right? There's also this section right here that I was like highlighting. I really like the section right here. Let me see. Oh, maybe if you could actually hear it. So I'm thinking we do something like this.
Okay,
something
remix.
Like that, right? So. Again, we have something similar to this pulled up here. So we're gonna grab that real quick.
I'm like hyper judgmental right now.
What was that?
Because you're flipping my sample.
Yeah. No, I can definitely feel the pressure right now. I can definitely feel the, please, I'm sensitive. Please don't do this to me. Thank you, sir. All right, so I'm thinking, yeah, something like this. So same principle, you know, we're just repeating that. Here's what I'm thinking, right?
What are you thinking?
We take this sample part, and again, we have this section that's like the main filter part, which again is like in principle like the exact same thing that we just chopped right here, right? And what I want to do with it is I want to make sure that there's nothing being overlaid on top of it so that we have kind of like a blank slate to work with things. So I'm thinking, you know, we have this, right? I want to add some sidechain to this. Just a little bit, right? And I picked out a kick, right? Let me find it, actually. Guess where that kick is. So for that kick, it's two kicks that I layered over one another. One where I'm like high passing it really hard. Basically, want to just keep the transient of that kick and like a little bit of like this hi-hat that I layered on top of it. I do some drum production, layer that on top, and, you know, I use it for later. But we have, like, a very big subby kick with, like, a hi-hat on top of it, effectively. So, okay, let's add this kick. All right. I like that, right?
So what? You just added a kick to it.
All right, fine. Then I'll add some hi-hats to it. So we got some percussion loops, we got a hat synth here, we got some shakers, and a 909 ride, right? Okay. I think we should add like a snare or something.
Yeah, I think it should.
I wonder if this is my snare. Actually, it's a clap. Wow. So this is like a 909 clap that we're adding on top of it. And remember how I said that we had high passed on this like main filter part? What we're gonna do is we wanna take, I don't know, like maybe something like a serum bass, right? Like, you know, like, whoa, what the? Here you go. That's not a bass.
Yo.
Something like that, right? God. That's pretty grimy.
That sounds just like the beginning of like a regular show episode.
Bow. There you go. So we came up with this like interesting bass line. Let's take a listen to it real quick. Let's layer that on top, see how it sounds like, right?
Shit.
Yeah, I think that's okay. I think it's pretty good, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So, let's go back to like this main part right here, right? So we have the filtery part, and what were we up to? What shenanigans were we up to? So let's listen from the very beginning. So what I've also done is I've taken that main sample. It's right here, right? And basically I've just taken that and extended it out and like repeated it right here. Right?
Right.
So I'm thinking, how about we have our hats, we have like quite a lot of stuff going on here.
Goddamn.
How about we add some guitar to this?
Whoa.
Whoa. Whoa. Thank you, Jam Clinic, for donating this guitar to us. I didn't know what I was going to do with it until now.
It was just our third guest.
Yeah, it was our third guest. He's just shy.
Our secret third thing.
So, let's take a listen. So, are we going to get audio through this? All right, let's do this.
Okay. Okay.
I like that.
I like that too.
I think that's kind of sick. So, what we're going to do is I think I'm going to grab this right here. And some of the processing that's going on, just a bit of, you know, like a clean amp sound. Adding some chorus on top of it. High passing. Do not touch.
Sorry.
Do not touch. Thank you. We're going to add just like a little bit of bit crush as well. Typically, I wouldn't do this, but I kind of think that it would work well for the gritty sound. You know, we're already adding like a bunch of filters and whatnot, and we can open up to a cleaner guitar sound at like the main portion of the track. And then a bunch of compression. If anybody here from Kauai Bass or Future Society is here, you know what this chain is. We don't talk about it. Okay. Quantum compression. All right. So, and then a little bit of high passing and then the side chain as well, just to give room for the kick. So let's take a listen to it. All right.
Okay.
Let's add our main guitar, right?
Yeah.
So I'm thinking something like this. That's a winner. So I was talking about opening it up, right? There's not as much going on like on this channel right here. So let's take a listen to it. And what I also think I want to do is I want to add some bells as well. Like a nice bell sound.
Yeah, get that sparkly bell sound.
So like kind of like a synth, like Juno 106 sort of bell sound. Like, damn, should have plugged in the MIDI keyboard for this. something lush, right? So let's listen to it with the guitar real quick. All right, I like this, right? All right, let's add the... What's this right here, actually? I have a sampler right here. What is this from?
It's your project.
Yeah, that's true. But I wonder what this is from. Huh. What? Oh, it's the time I loaded Fart with Reverb in the project. That's awesome. Okay, let's pretend that didn't happen. Let's cut that. Let's listen from the very beginning and see how this came out. All right, I'm gonna add like a... Okay, we're doing good. Adding some limited, like a limiter. Think about that. Hey.
Should we drop?
Do you guys think we should finish this?
Should we drop this?
You think we should finish this a bit?
Let's drop this. Like a bomb.
Like right now. No, I think we should work on this and expand it more. Maybe actually release it as a full track. Because yeah. I like the idea.
Yeah.
Yeah? Sick. All right.
Okay. Well,
we've made the track.
We
flipped
it.
We kiss?
No.
Oh, okay.
We did it. Yay. Guys.
How'd this dude pull my earring straight off?
Wait, did I? Got your nose too.
Oh no. You wouldn't be able to see because I'm wearing the mask.
Because I took your nose.
All right, cool guys. So. Oh. Whoopsies.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, everybody.
Wait. 3, 2, 1.
Thank you, everybody,
for coming
to Future Funk. How it's made with fiber. You really gonna make me do
this? Wait.
Okay, and 3, 2, 1.
Thank you for coming to Future Funk. How it's made
with fiber
and Discoholic.
Okay. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
All right. We got a few last words before I let y'all go. Join us for our meet and greet happening in 15 minutes. Basically now, if you'd like to follow us to it, come down with us and follow us to the atrium. It is right behind registration. Rock Island will be bringing our merch if you would like to buy it or get it signed or talk to us, et cetera, et cetera. Speaking of merch, our newest vinyl, Discoholics Anonymous, is coming out in February. We have copies of it for the first time ever. We actually have a few we want to show you guys.
This is the first time. Oh my God, yeah. We have vinyl. Where is it?
We have vinyl. So, first off, we're going to do the Boogie Blue. This is the Boogie Blue variant. Check that out. Right? And then, drum roll please. Right? And then, you're not ready for this one. Cosmic Cocktail.
Cosmic Cocktail.
Right? Drum roll, please.
Whoa.
Right? Wow. Very, very cool. If you shine it in the light, it's like this crazy... I don't even know how the hell they did this, to be honest with you.
It's a cosmic cocktail.
I do also want to mention, we have a Rendezvous vinyl as well. We have a few variants of that.
Yes.
We have a purple and a blue, but we also have a Nebula and a Wax Mage.
This is the Wax Mage,
Very cool. Right? And we have quite a few others. We have tapes as well. Volume 2, Discoholics Anonymous and Rendezvous. We have t-shirts.
T-shirts.
Yeah, t-shirts.
Look at how drippy I am. Okay. And we also have a bunch of stickers, keychains, posters, and whatnot.
Yes,
so
little
please help support us.
Buy.
It would really mean a lot.
And hot sauce.
And disco sauce. We have signed disco sauce. Yeah.
Oh, that sauce is fire.
Yeah.
Thank you.
It's like
you.
A citrusy sauce. But either way, does anybody here have any questions before we wrap things up and go to the meet and greet?
Regarding the vinyls.
What's up?
Are there any, like, there's only 500 copies of this or 1,000 copies of this one? For like,
it's like 150 Boogie Blue, 150 Cosmic Cocktail. But and we have 20 of each selling today.
We brought 20 of each.
Does anybody have questions about the panel? And whatnot? Yeah.
I was curious more about the R&B like section that wasn't, that ended up getting sampled. So the progression there.
What's
can
up?
You talk about the progression that you're looking for in the R&B or in the disco that, you know, builds tension mm-hmm. and excitement.
What's up? So what was the question specifically?
What kinds of progressions, like chord progressions, do you look for, or do you compose?
You know, you can look at a theory standpoint of it, honestly, but you know, for a lot of people, I think especially people who are just like sampling these sorts of tracks, it's really just what feels good. It really just like it's not something that like necessarily like can be calculated and whatnot. It's just like, you know, I just really like this part, you know, and I think it would go well with this part. The thing that I've noticed and I've kind of like picked up over the years is that if you are, I guess, how should I put this? If you are making something that makes you feel something, then most likely somebody else is going to feel something as well, right? And sometimes like with music, it almost can't be explained. What do you think, Disco?
Wait, I didn't hear the question.
So the question was like when we're picking out from like stuff like disco samples, R&B and whatnot,
yeah.
what we're looking for and what to look for in general.
Ooh. Honestly, I feel like listening to a lot of songs and just kind of like taking notes or mental notes of like the parts that make you like...
It really comes down to mental notes, I think.
It's really kind of... Future Funk is kind of like a way to like... extract the pure dopamine from those specific chord progressions.
Exactly.
Just like loop them into like French House.
I think we're gonna take like two more questions and then we're gonna start packing up for the meet and greet.
Yeah, yeah.
Yep.
Yes, so when it comes down to chopping up, like say for example, you have like copyright music that you're chopping up and sampling, right?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think is like the threshold of using said samples to the point where it's not gonna be like...
If you're asking about whether or not using uncleared samples and like how short or long it should be to like avoid like a potential lawsuit or something,
yeah.
It's
sample.
Like, yeah, literally make the sample. Even if you use a micro sample and it is somehow identified, they could send you a cease and desist. It's happened to friends before. It really just comes down to like, I guess like if you want like quote unquote masking your tracks, micro sampling, adding original instrumentation is gonna make it a lot easier, but there's no safe ground for it. Copyright law is very complicated.
Right.
You all the way in the back.
What's up with that compression chain?
Okay, so the nitty and gritty of it is that Unibeat, who's like a Future Funk producer in the scene, made this chain that he would not stop adding things to, and it stopped overblowing things and actually started making things quieter, so we didn't really know how it worked, so we dubbed it quantum compression. And it's just like an inside joke, like in like our like, you know, little space. But like basically the chain that I had there was me taking his giant chain and like removing unnecessary parts of it and like basically making it like a compression chain.
Okay.
For like processing samples and instruments and whatnot. Yep. That's the last question, by the way. So yeah.
Oh,
yep.
Discoholic. How excited is Cube to be at MAGFest?
What?
How excited is Cube to be at MAGFest?
Oh man, how excited is Cube to be at MAGFest?
He's in the hotel. Oh, he's probably in MAGFest. He's probably watching the live stream.
Yeah, he's probably trying to like, you know, talk to the VR chat.
Cube isn't here,
wall.
But if he was, he would probably be LARPing all day.
Yeah, you would totally, you totally find him in the LARP room for 100%.
He would like spend hours in like the arcade. And like
for sure.
24-hour arcade.
Yeah. All right, guys, thank you so much.
Let's do a selfie, guys. Let's do a
you
selfie.
You guys want to do a selfie? Yep.
Yeah. Oh, you do the selfie?
Yeah, I'll do the selfie. Okay. You're blind. You're probably just gonna take a photo of the ceiling or something. Show up for the meet and greet again, happening in the atrium.
Follow
registration
us.
Right behind registration at Autographs. Thank you.